Photosynthesis is one of those topics that is really interesting because, to me, all life depends on it. If we didn't have photosynthesis, we really wouldn't have a living set of organisms. We wouldn't have the atmosphere we do, and we really would have not much of a planet to speak of. Certainly not one with a lot of living organisms. Now, to give you a basic introduction, the first thing we need is to establish a little bit of terminology. There's no way to get around this, and so we'll just dive right in. The place where photosynthesis occurs is the other of the energy organelles, and it's called the chloroplast. Now, if you recall, the energy organelle for cellular respiration was the mitochondria, and now we're dealing with the chloroplast. Chloroplasts are located in something called the mesophyll, and the term mesophyll is, again, it's part of your Greek lesson for the day. Meso means middle, and phyll means tissue, so it's the middle tissue of a leaf. It is surrounded by a viscous liquid, or the chloroplasts are filled, I should say, with a viscous liquid called stroma. That's basically just like the cytoplasm that we have in our cells. Inside of a chloroplast is called stroma. And there are lots and lots of membranes. These membranes are called thylakoids, and I'll show you a picture of those in just a minute, and you can stack these up. So they don't just have little membrane space here and there, they have a solid block of stacks of membranes all over the chloroplast, and these are called grana. So a lot of important membrane space, workbench space, is needed to conduct the business of a chloroplast. One key component that we also don't have is light-absorbing pigments. The most important one of these is chlorophyll, and chlorophyll is the molecule that is able to take up the light energy and convert it into chemical energy. And that's the process we're going to investigate, of course. Now, here you have a picture of the things that I just told you. So first of all, you have the leaf. This here is the middle layer. There's a top layer, as you can see here. There's a little cuticle on the leaf. Then there is the first layer of cells here. Then you have the middle layer, the mesophyll. And then at the bottom, you have the same thing again. You have a cell layer, and you have a cuticle. Sometimes this is made of wax, especially in an area where it's warm outside, because that way the leaf doesn't lose as much water. They have these little openings called stoma, that's one, and it's stomata, that's the plural, stomata. And that's their area for gas exchange. That's where the carbon dioxide goes in and the oxygen goes out. Now, this is very similar in terms of gas exchange to what happens in our lungs, except it's the other thing that goes in, it's the other thing that goes out. But in principle, it's the same. These individual little cells, and here's one of those cells, they have all kinds of little chloroplasts inside. Leaf cells are chock-a-block full with chloroplasts because that's their business. Their business is to turn the light into chemical energy. And when you look inside of one of these chloroplasts, first of all, you see it has an outer membrane, it has an inner membrane, just like the mitochondria did. But then, in addition, it has all these membrane spaces here. And you can see this in the actual electron microscopy picture. There's all these stacks with all these layers. So there is a lot of workbench space, more so than in the mitochondria. This is very tightly folded membrane space. When you look at photosynthesis in terms of its overall equation, then you have to recognize and see what its input and its output are. And so you're looking at photosynthesis as a process by which so-called autotrophic organisms convert light into chemical energy. Autotrophic. You know what an automobile is. That's a thing that self-propels itself. So these things are self-feeding. And what we mean by self-feeding is that they don't have to go and find food. The food will come to them. And the food that comes to them comes to them in the form of light energy. We can't do this. We are heterotrophic. Hetero, in that sense, means other. Other, which means that we have to go and find our food. So that's the difference between autotrophic and heterotrophic organisms. Now, clearly, all heterotrophic organisms are going to depend on autotrophic organisms because they are the only ones who can pick up the light. And so if we're looking at this in terms of a food chain, heterotrophs are going to eat those kinds of organisms. Now, during the process of photosynthesis, we are making sugar, so this is what's being made here, and we're making it from carbon dioxide and water. So our input is carbon dioxide and water, and sugar and oxygen are released in this. Well, that's exactly the reverse of cellular respiration. So look at this equation. Again, it's a balanced equation. If you were to flip back to chapter 6, you would see that the components are the same, exactly the same. The difference in this diagram is that here we have a leaf, and of course, in addition to having a leaf, we have energy coming in from light. That's the difference. Light energy is coming in as opposed to chemical energy going out to the cells. But other than that, it's the same. Now, if you look at processes like this, and if you see processes that are so similar to each other, one of the questions you would ask yourself is it possible to turn one of these processes into the other by simply running things the other way around? So if you have a process like cellular respiration, you take the sugar, you break it apart, that's glycolysis, you break it apart even further, that's citric acid cycle, and then you use the electrons. If you reverse that, you'd basically have something like photosynthesis. And so when we look at this just in terms of a flow chart, you might say, well, if we go back to cellular respiration and we reverse it, then what we need to do is we need to take the electron transport chain and start with that. And then we have some kind of a cycle next, and then we somehow make the glucose. So if we're going to reverse the cycle, this is what we would need. Something is going to start this process that handles electrons. So we would expect to have some kind of an electron transport chain first. The second thing, we want some kind of a cycle if we're going to reverse it. And then the third thing is simply to make glucose. So those are the three things. If you go this way around, it's cellular respiration. If you go that way around, it's photosynthesis. That's the idea, conceptually. So now the question is that actually what we see? And it's very interesting because when people started to study this and to put the pieces together, the details of cellular respiration, they found that there is really a lot of resemblance between these two processes. So predicting what might happen in photosynthesis as part of the scientific method is a very powerful concept. And so here actually is your photosynthesis roadmap. It turns out that there are two parts to this. The first one is called the light reactions. And that's where light is converted to chemical energy. So obviously, this is a very important part of this process. The second part, called the Calvin cycle, that is where we ultimately turn the carbon dioxide into sugar. Now, if you look at this with the prediction we just made, so here, this step here, whatever this arrow is, that's what makes the glucose. And lo and behold, there is a cycle here. So there's step number 2. And if steps 3 and 2 from the previous slide are already there, well then our guess would be, remember